Australia, the largest island in the world with the greatest number of landscapes. A country isolated for so many years that its wildlife is some of the most unique anywhere. Home to only 22 million people from 200 different countries. Australia's a place that's crying out to be explored, and I've got just the way to do it. Last year, I flew across Africa in a hot air balloon. The landscape was awe-inspiring. The wildlife was amazing, but the ballooning, that was a revelation. So as soon as I could, I was planning my next adventure, and nowhere says adventure like Australia. Over the next 4 weeks, I'll be traveling across the southeast corner. I'll start in South Australia, taking in the Flinders Ranges and Barossa Valley, travel east to the state of Victoria and the cities of Mildura and Melbourne, and finish up in New South Wales, where Sydney, the Blue Mountains and Canowindra, Australia's ballooning capital, are on the agenda. As well as flying over vastly different terrains, I'll be trying to experience as much of Aussie life as I can. Because when I get to Canowindra, I plan to enter Australia's biggest balloon competition. Losing isn't an option, so I need to know as much as possible about what makes Australia tick. To ensure a British victory at Canowindra, I've assembled the best team possible. First in my basket is my African ballooning companion, pilot Robin Bachelor. Then there's Matthew, a Sydney-based Brit who'll be Robin's co-pilot. Victor's next, our crew chief and token Kiwi. And finally, Daisy, our red and white candy-striped balloon designed by and named after my 9-year-old daughter. Yeah, in 4 weeks' time, there's the biggest ballooning competition that Australia has to offer. And I foolishly entered us representing Great Britain. I think Australia poses a lot more challenges than we've ever faced before.
In the wide, wide world, are we?
There's quite a lot of rivalry between England and Australia, and I think it will just spur us on a bit. If we're going to take them on in their backyard, we need to throw down the gauntlet, and being a pommy, you have no choice but that.
1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, emu! Hey! Now mind where you step or swim in Australia. The following animals aren't ranked in any order. They're all pretty much dangerous. There's the death adder. The clue's in the name with that one. The red-back spider, the box jellyfish, the stonefish, the Australian paralysis tick, which can strike at any...
that's good.
We're heading for South Australia, a state that's 4 times the size of the UK. North of Adelaide, the state's capital, the dry, unforgiving countryside is known as the Outback. Temperatures reach 50 degrees Celsius in these parts, which won't make me popular with the boys, but should be the wake-up call they need to get competition ready.
There you go, mate!
Gentlemen, welcome to the Outback.
So I thought we'd taken a wrong turn there. We're still in Australia.
Yeah, no, you are. Still in the heart of the Outback. I'm just out here doing a bit of camel training, getting ready for racing.
So is there a big history of camels in Australia?
There is. The camel, he opened up inland of Australia. The first camels to come to Australia was in 1840. They come out from the Canary Islands. They say a rough estimate of 1 million wild camels here in Australia running wild.
Yeah?
Yeah. Now, in captivity, they'd probably be about 600,000-700,000 in captivity. Mm. So there's quite a few, yeah.
Is that more than anywhere else in the world then?
For wild camels, yeah.
So they've taken over?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And these are dromedaries?
Dromedaries, yes. They're the one humps. You two hump the Bactrian. He's your real proper camel.
So Australia was built on the hump of a camel.
Oh, yes, yep.
Our first stop is Parachilna, a town close to the Flinders, the largest mountain range in South Australia, and where we'll be attempting our first flight. 1.6 million people live in South Australia, and just seven of them live in Parachilna. In the 1880s, when Parachilna had a thriving copper mine, the town's Prairie Hotel was where you went for a hard-earned beer. Now, with no obvious source of food for miles, I personally wouldn't order a mixed grill.
Feral mixed grill?
I say, a what mixed grill?
The feral mixed grill.
Feral? Oh, right. Gosh.
You've got some interesting flags there. Thank you.
No! Oh. That's camel.
When the journey so far to get to the outback has been strenuous, arduous. We've seen emu, we've seen kangaroo, seen camel. Robin's eaten them all.
I never thought I'd eat camel sausage.
And?
I mean, I always tell my passengers. Exactly.
One thing you can't help but notice when you drive into the outback is how the landscape changes. It's tougher, harsher, more unforgiving. And you need to be the hardiest of all Australians to survive out here, like these stockmen that I've just met.
I don't know whether there's
who's
any
got the ashes at the moment.
It's
all gone quiet.
I'll tell you what.
It's suddenly gone quiet.
Good night's sleep is one thing you think you could count on in Parachilna, but every evening, a 1.7-mile-long train rattles through the town on its way to collect coal from the mine at Lee Creek. The locals insist it's a sight not to be missed. Not that there was any real risk of that happening.
That's a big train.
A new day and a beautiful dawn, and at last it's time to fly.
So we're going to climb over the ranges here. This is going to be the north side of the Wilpena Pound, and then we're going to try and target this number 12 here, the Morilana Plain. We're hoping to set down here, yes. So when we get over the top of the ridge here, it's really going to accelerate. You've got to be on your toes here because you're going to have to get down quick enough before you get to this Mount Burns range, because if you get there, then you're going to be in trouble again. Yeah. So you have to land at this Morilana Plain.
Right.
Otherwise, we probably won't pick you up till this afternoon sometime.
Okay. Right.
Cool.
Let's saddle up. Burn. Seems to work all right.
Where's your eyebrows
gone, number one?
Okay, ready?
Okay. On three.
One, two, three, and up.
So, our maiden flight in Australia, everyone's terribly excited. There is a palpable tingle in the air.
Stretching for 267 miles, the Flinders Ranges dominate the outback. This morning, we'll get a view of them like few have, as we attempt a flight across Wilpena Pound, a 30-square-mile natural amphitheatre in the heart of the ranges.
Let go, stand by, you.
Wait off, please, everybody.
OK. Release.
With Canowindra's balloon challenge just 4 weeks away, this ambitious flight should kickstart our training nicely.
Wow, we've done it! Do you know, that's the most fantastic feeling. Now, I've got to climb quickly to clear those mountains, so...
Yeah, that's,
I'll
always,
carry on
that's
up.
Always good in my book.
We're climbing at 600 feet a minute.
Did you know, Skipper?
Yeah.
That the Flinders Ranges were once as high as the Himalayas. They're at this height now because of erosion, but we can now safely say that we're on top of the world. You see the shape of the pound?
Yes.
Now, it's said...
There it is.
It's said that the Aboriginal people reckon that it's like the body of two snakes.
Man, that is incredible.
just feel like the only people on the planet.
But despite all the planning, our balloon flight over the Flinders Ranges ends in a way none of us expected.
Get ready, lads. Yeah. Hold on now. Brace, brace, brace.
My Australian balloon adventure looks set to get off to an impressive start with a flight over South Australia's Flinders Ranges. It took early settlers the best part of 50 years to find a way to cross the 267-mile-long range, and with any luck, it will take Robin and I about an hour. We're aiming to cross the ranges at Wilpena Pound, a rock amphitheatre that takes its name from an Aboriginal word meaning cupped hands.
We topped out at about 3,500 feet back there, but yeah. We swung right round about 90 degrees right. To a direction which is not good.
Matt, if you take a bearing on the balloon from where you are, you should be able to confirm which road I'll end up landing on.
Yeah, roger that. Well, we've got, hopefully we're going to get you between the Hawker and Parachilna Road, so, just make sure you're near the road somewhere, otherwise you're on your own.
What's that sort of bank of cloud that way? It's not rain, is it?
Yes, it is.
When it comes to ballooning, you're always at the mercy of the winds. But in the hot and harsh South Australian outback, you're even more so. It's common for the winds to pick up as the sun rises, but here in Wilpena Pound, the wind speed is surprisingly changeable, making it really difficult for us to plot our next move.
217, 217. That's almost south. We're heading, this is entirely an unpredictable direction. Let's check the fuel. 20% on the first tank. As we clear this ridge, we've got to be very careful of curl over, because as the wind comes over the ridge, it tumbles down the other side quite dramatically. It's very
unstable. So would that drag us with it?
It would, yes, and it would knock air out of the balloon.
It looks like the wind's picking up. Let me know what you reckon the wind speed is when you can.
Yeah, wind speed's around about 10 to 15 knots at the moment down here.
So that rain might be catching us up.
The planes over there look ideal for landing.
So it's got to be coming.
As we spot our landing site and start to descend, it's immediately obvious that the winds are furious and it's going to be a very fast landing.
We're not going down, we've got to get down. Get ready, lads.
Yeah.
Now's the time. Hold yourself backwards. Face backwards, hold on with both hands. Hold on, both hands, hold on now. Okay, lads. Oh, go easy. All okay? You all right, Stephen? Is he unconscious?
The impact was incredibly strong, and of course we had Steve, the cameraman, and Luke, the sound man, with us as well. As soon as we hit, I was upside down. The initial jolt nearly put me teeth through me brain.
All good.
And then we were just dragged, and it didn't feel like we were going to stop.
The last I looked at the GPS, it was registering 35 knots. I then just stopped looking. We hit here.
And 35 knots translates at nearly 40 miles an hour.
40 miles an hour, yeah. Easily the fastest landing I've ever done in all my life.
And we managed to move this rock out the way that I'm sitting on from there,
Fortunately, it went this way and not inside the basket, because can barely lift it. If it had moved the other way, I think that would have been the last of us, which gives you pause for thought, certainly.
Oh, look, my altimeter! Oh, no!
Steve, the cameraman, took it the worst in the small of his back, and he's been ambulanced away, which you don't like to see, and my thoughts are with him at the moment and hope he makes a speedy recovery.
Now and again, Mother Nature really tests you, and by Jove, today she tested me to the limits.
Yeah, I think we're lucky to be sitting here talking to you, frankly.
And they look fine, 100%.
Yeah, well, that's all your support comes from.
Yeah, that's the important thing.
Okay.
See what the bottom's like.
I'm trying not to think about the negatives. I think the positives we have to take out of it are that we're all still fine. The word's come back from the hospital that Steve, the cameraman, has been released and he's okay.
Aha. Well,
there lies our issue.
I'm quite keen to, you know, get back in the saddle again, prove that it wasn't something that would dampen our spirits in any way.
Well, that's obviously where the rock hit, on the right-hand side here.
Now, think of the force involved in bending that socket.
Robin is an ace pilot and prepares for things like that, and, you know, he'd controlled it so well, that was the best that we could do with it. We will push on, and we'll have much more beautiful experiences than that, and we just chalk this one off to a bit of freak weather.
As it'll take Robin and Matthew some time to repair the balloon basket, I've decided to join the stockman I met at the Prairie Hotel for a day on their cattle station. Stations in this part of the country are larger than some European countries, so light aircraft is the only way to travel. Talk about out of the frying pan and into a very large fire. Thankfully, I land safely on Nilpena Station, a 408,000-acre property. After a 10-year drought, it's finally rained, so it's all hands on deck to tag a frightening number of cattle and move them to greener pastures. As it's a busy day, I'm hoping the stockmen are far too distracted to notice my interesting riding style. Honestly, it's my first time on a horse, but if anyone asks, I'll be blaming an old ballooning injury.
You picked out your favourite yet, Steve? Go on, in you go. Oi, oi, oi. One of the hardest things to put up with in the bush or in this low rainfall area is when your cattle and your horses get low in condition, you know?
Right.
You know, and they're your livelihood and you like to see them good and healthy, but
yeah,
you don't like to see them bogged in the water, trying to get a drink in the dams, or no water, perishing, starving,
yeah,
you know? That's when it gets cruel and hard to put up with. Get in there.
Australia's the largest beef exporter in the world. So not surprisingly, in South Australia, cattle outnumber people by about 15 to 1.
Ross will earmark him now and we're at him. Girlie. There you go.
So apart from the hat, obviously, do you think I've got the makings of a stockman?
Oh, I tell you what,
we've
made good men out of worse than you before, man. Just don't be half-hearted about it, see? Up and down them. Surprise it. Twist it round. Hey, twist it round the other way.
The other way? Best way?
Nah.
I've got them in a headlock now.
It's amazing, you know. I mean, they're making good stockmen out of girls these days.
What are you saying?
Nothing's impossible.
Well, I wanted to try and experience what it's like to be a real stockman in the outback, and frankly, I think I'm a little bit out of my depth. I don't feel the part, I certainly don't look the part. I mean, look at Gordon.
He's had that moustache since he was three. I mean, it's a veritable privet edge he's got in his top lip. You could perform topiary on it.
And something else I've discovered is why a lot of Australians talk like this, so they don't get half a dozen flies in their gob.
While I've been away playing Stockman, Robin's given Daisy a clean bill of health. All that's left to do is a controlled test flight. Vast, remote and arid, the outback is often described as the never never, and after our experience, I'm not surprised. But however battered and bruised we are by the Flinders, it's done nothing to kill our spirits.
Guitar solo, come out, Robin. Granddad! Come on, son, get finished. Hello, Wembley.
So we've left the sort of barren, desolate, rustic charm of the outback, and the scenery is now gently morphed into more temperate, undulating hills.
The best flight of my life was flying right across the Swiss Alps. There's a lovely balloon meet in the winter in January.
We're in the middle of the Barossa Valley, which is the famous wine-producing region of Australia.
And I flew 200 miles in 4 hours. Breathtaking views in that gin desert.
6 hours, 400 miles and countless stories later, we arrive at our destination. The Barossa's home to some of Australia's oldest vineyards, now famous for growing Shiraz grapes. Shiraz like temperate weather, and after our run-in with the Flinders Ranges winds, I look forward to a few days of that myself. Next stop on my Australian adventure, I enjoy an unforgettable flight over the Barossa's Golden Hills. But the peace is short-lived when a pleasant wine tasting turns into a cricket match to settle an old score. After an eventful landing in South Australia's Flinders Ranges, I'm grateful to be in the Barossa Valley, where there's nothing but rolling hills and gentle winds.
Well, if it stays like this, lovely cut stubble fields, I'll be a happy bunny. But I kind of think we're going to head into
somebody's vineyard.
I know. I must not land in a vineyard.
As the Barossa is named after a famous 18th century battle where the British beat the French, I'm quietly confident it's a good omen for our upcoming balloon competition in New South Wales. Looking down at the rows of vines, it's not hard to believe that Australia is one of the top four wine exporters in the world.
This area was mainly where the German settlers came.
Yeah.
About 1850.
Yes, there's still a strong influence. It's interesting to think of all those early settlers choosing a big, arid, harsh place like Australia, but they've succeeded.
The industry has certainly come a long way from its early days when vines from the Cape of Good Hope were brought out by the First Fleet to Botany Bay. Attempts at growing the vines failed, and it wasn't until the German immigrants to the Barossa Valley brought their winemaking knowledge that things really got going.
So the vista's changed quite dramatically from the outback. It's much more agricultural. There's farm buildings dotted around everywhere. I think some of the most famous names you get around here, Wolf Blass and Penfold.
Yes.
The first bottle of red wine I ever saw in a British shop would be early 70s, and it was called Kangaroo Rouge. It looks like little strips of green corduroy.
They do, don't they? Just slightly worn. I never normally guarantee, but I'll do my best to promise you a lovely, gentle landing this time.
Well, in comparison, anything will be a gentle landing.
Yeah. It's about 18 miles an hour. We can find... Yeah, exactly. Chicken feet.
That's nothing.
Landing in 30 seconds. Bounce a bit. Ready? 5 feet, 4 feet, 3 feet, 2 feet, 1 feet. OK, we're down. And we've stopped. Whew. Well, Stephen, welcome back to Terra Firma.
Indeed. Nice landing, Skip.
Thanks.
Oh, that was a blissful landing. Oh, that was lovely.
That flight has... it's brought all the normal delights of ballooning flooding back.
Exactly.
I mean, the contrast in emotions just in 2 or 3 days, it's ridiculous. To be honest, I almost thought I'd never get in a basket again. I dare not put it into words.
Mm.
It was the most difficult landing I think I've ever done.
Yeah, I would confidently say that confidence is completely restored.
Ah, welcome back.
Oh, it's good. How was it? It's fantastic.
There's a tradition in ballooning to toast your landing with a glass of champagne. It started in the 1700s in France, when balloonists gave frightened farmers bubbly to convince them they weren't from outer space.
Nothing to it, really.
With no champagne on hand, a visit to a winery is the next best thing.
So here we have a 3-ton fermenting vat of Cabernet Sauvignon from the Barossa. This would have been in here for a few days now. Ben is doing what we call a pump over.
Here, when you see the whole process and you get to taste the history in a way, as Matthew was describing, there are some vines here that have been going for over 100 years, so there's a lot of respect for it.
Wine is living history. It takes a year to grow, and then it can take up to 2 years in barrel before it's released.
Mm-hmm.
So this is why when you're tasting an old wine from, I don't know, say 1945, it's not just about that year's harvest, it's about everything that happened to the people who made it in the 50 years, 60 years since. So this wine, in inverted commas, is about 10 days old. So you can see from the colour.
It was about 5 years ago I decided to stop drinking. I'd put in an awful lot of effort before then. I got to about 39, and I think if it, in Tom and Jerry terms, I'd have had one of those meters that said full. And it was taking up a lot of time. And I used to find that the hangovers were getting worse the older I got, and you'd spend a lot of days trying to play catch-up. And I needed the energy to be a better dad to Daisy and to concentrate more on my work. So I thought it was about time to stop.
This is called the barrel thief, because it goes into the barrel, it thieves some wine, comes back out again. The other wine that is lost to the atmosphere is called the angel share.
Oh, how lovely.
I think in the old days, I'd have dived in one of those 3-ton barrels and you wouldn't have seen me for the rest of the trip.
Oh,
Seems to have evaporated, Skipper.
It's so light and so, so smooth.
It's a lot lighter now.
It is. Would be a chance of a drop more often.
I'm sure there would be.
I'm glad I had the old spittoon with me as well, because you can tell what it's like if you don't have the spittoon by Robin's dulcet tones and the various singing we've been treated to.
Waltzing Matilda! Mm. Waltzing Matilda!
Yeah, I think you're going to have to work on the unofficial Australian national anthem.
I can smell roses, I can dream of croquet.
You can smell roses, you're turning into Gilly Goulden and Oz Clark.
Exactly.
We've had a magnificent wine tour, and flying over the vineyards this morning was spectacular. But there's no such thing as a free lunch, and the prize for the hospitality of letting us fly over there is, in typical Aussie fashion, they've challenged us to a game of cricket. Cricket grounds around the world are fantastic, magical places, and this one is exceptional. So it's England against Australia. There's a lot of pride at stake, so it'll be a very lively affair.
The match will take place at the CCG, the Chateau Cricket Ground, the winery's very own pitch. As unusual as this seems, this is the country where cricket's almost the national religion.
Robin and I persuaded them to open a few bottles early, so I think that might stand in our favour. But of course, Robin is leading from the front, that's just in the drinking.
The Aussie winemakers we'll be playing against might have the home team advantage, but we have British initiative.
Robin, I think the last time he played was when I was born, which was in the mid-60s. And he rather crudely said the last time he hit any balls was when he trod on a rake.
Before I got here.
Do you want us to put a rattle in it for you?
Yeah, we showed you how to do this thing.
Right. Off you go. Oh.
Mama! Shot! Oh, oh, Robin, run it!
Yeah! Oh, Jason!
Certainly didn't wear out that bat.
Ah, you should see me on a good day.
Yes! Yeah.
Good ball.
Oh, you did it!
Now, the Aussies love a bet. The more inventive, the better, as we're in the Barossa, an area steeped in German heritage.
Take the long walk of shame, buddy.
The winemakers have suggested whoever loses the match has to help the local all-male choir, the Liedertafel, with a spot of fundraising for their historic organ. My Australian adventure continues as I push on to Victoria to fly over the mighty Murray.
This is just beautiful.
But my attempts to embrace a local custom fail miserably.
Ah, oh, mate!
After our game of cricket against the Barossa Valley winemakers didn't go to plan, it's a relief to have moved on to Mildura, Victoria. To make sure we don't make a habit of defeat, I've sent Matthew and Victor on to New South Wales to recce the site of the ballooning competition we're entering in just a few weeks' time. As it's just Robin and me for the next few days, we plan to make the most of being in the town known as Victoria's Food Bowl.
Well, that's what you call a hearty breakfast.
It's at a farmer's market.
Mildura's on the edge of the outback, so the key to the town's food industry is irrigation. Just as well, Australia's largest river, the Murray, runs right past the town. We've got plans to balloon over the Murray, but for now I've got my heart set on floating down it on a houseboat.
Something about getting up with the sun and gives you an incredible appetite for life. So while Robin's outsourcing a houseboat for us, I'm going to go round the market here, which has got the freshest produce, see what I can buy to rustle up a fantastic meal for us both later.
Bag of those, please. And some of them.
I'll be back for an apple slice.
Okay.
Can you save me four?
Well,
okay, the crowd's gathering. They're getting a bit scared of this group.
As I discovered in the Barossa Valley, the gambling mad Aussies will bet on anything. It's a long-standing joke that two flies crawling up a wall would encourage an Aussie to place a wager. And this morning, we're not far off that, as bets are being placed on some racing yabbies.
Well, at the farmer's market, there's a tradition that goes on called yabby racing. Now, a yabby is a freshwater crayfish, often found in rivers and dams. They number the backs of each of them, put them in the middle of the circle, and the first yabby to get to the outer white circle is the winner. We're on number four, so keep your eyes peeled.
And the yabbies are on, and we mix there in the middle. There they go. There, oh, it's a big mix up in the middle. They're not very happy. The big guy, he's spattered. He's going to say, "I'm not playing it."
He's facing the wrong way.
There's a couple of really spattered. And they pulled it off. Oh!
Well, from the off, he started off slow and then got progressively slower. I thought it was a tactic and then he was going to come in on the rails, but no. Demonstrated the same physical prowess as Robin did during the cricket match, which was a handicap to begin with. If all else fails, apparently these are good eating.
At just under 1,500 miles long, the Murray runs along the border of New South Wales and Victoria and then into South Australia. That's almost twice the distance of Land's End to John O'Groats. I'm pretty sure we won't be covering those distances today, not with Robin at the helm.
You wouldn't get this sort of behaviour at Henley.
Well, Robin's... I shouldn't have left him in charge, really, but he's blown the budget entirely on this magnificent houseboat. He's decided that skippering the balloon isn't enough and he's gone for the biggest vessel that he could possibly find.
There's nothing this houseboat doesn't have, including several fishing rods. The Murray's famous for Australia's largest freshwater fish, the Murray cod. The cod can grow up to 6 foot long and weigh up to 100 kilograms. Landing one is a two-person job, though Robin's taking his new role rather seriously, so I think I'm on my own.
It's not until you travel around Australia, and especially seeing the amazing views we do from Daisy, from the air, that you realise what an incredibly vast and differing country it is.
Bloody foreigners.
We've had varying degrees of success with our ballooning. It was almost Stephen Tompkinson's posthumous Australian balloon adventure. And it's all, you know, it's a learning process, and the more we go, the more we learn, and the keener we get, I think, to this final competition. It's gearing us up in exactly the right way.
Yes. Perfect way to the end of a good day.
I think so. Well, you've had a few bumps and bruises this week.
It's been a relaxing day, but I've still got a British win at Canowindra on my mind. Tomorrow morning, preparations for the competition continue with a flight over Mildura. Come on, you didn't really think I'd eat him, did you?
Well, we're on the banks of the Murray this morning. You can hear the kookaburras in the distance, the laughing jackasses.
It's a real Aussie balloon now. It's full of dirt, full of birds, probably full of few spiders in here as well.
We've got a new balloon crew. We've got Paul and Dino helping us this morning because Matt and Victor are wrecking launch sites. So we're looking to sort of
trace the route of the Murray for a bit and see what's out that-a-way.
The aircraft traffic from Melbourne comes in from the southeast.
Yeah.
So, Robin, if you find yourself within 5 kilometres, it's a 2,000-foot overfly.
Right,
so we'd like you up at 2,000 AGL, which is about 2,200 feet.
Yes.
As Paul is Australia's top sporting balloonist, I'm confident we're in safe hands. I just hope he's prepared to set old rivalries aside to teach me all he knows. Our flight this morning sees us take in the northwest corner of the state of Victoria. Named after Queen Victoria, the state is Australia's smallest, but with just under 5 million people, it's the most populated.
Thank you very much.
See you on the flip side.
You betcha.
Despite its size, the state is famous for having the most varied weather in the country.
Ah, look, the sun's just starting to rise.
It's 6:30 a.m. and balmy here, but in the Victorian Alps, in the state's northeast corner, it's chilly. While in Melbourne, the state's capital, is pouring with rain.
It's interesting to think how important this huge Murray River is to the development of this community and the industries.
Well, to all of Australia.
Yeah. And poor old Adelaide, at the very end of it, gets a fairly sort of iffy quality of water after everybody else has had their share.
Spotting a black swan on the river brings my native bird count up. But with 350 species of birds unique to Australia, I've got some way to go.
This is just beautiful.
I'm always irresistibly drawn towards large masses of water to fly low. There's something called...
I haven't got my water wings with me.
You haven't got your best Gucci shoes on, have you? I'm in danger of boring myself with all this, but I just can't believe the beauty of this sky, the colours, the complete clarity of the air. There's no pollution. I'm so lucky. Yeah, this clean, clean air.
Just see miles and miles to the horizon in every direction.
Yeah. Good
lads. There's the convoy.
And I'm bored.
The dog gossip.
Yes, yeah.
Telegraph poles.
There's a frequency in the sound of the burner that dogs can pick up before the human ear can.
We've got three paddle steamers parked up on the river there.
Before planes and trains made it easy to travel across Australia, the Murray and its paddle steamers were an important source of transport. Wool, wheat and gold were all shipped along the river to Melbourne and Sydney, and from there, the rest of the world.
So that's where we leave the River Murray behind. We're now north of the river, and we must stay there. So we're landing in about 30 seconds. So on your feet, bends your knees, hold on tight with both hands. Touchdown in about 10 seconds. All right, here we go. Geronimo!
Keep it upright, Skip.
Yep, yep.
Another one bites the dust.
Next time, after weeks in the bush, I head to Melbourne and meet the locals.
Nice day for it.
I drop into the MCG in more ways than one. And I get invited to the biggest Greek festival in Australia. And somehow manage to offend the hosts.